Here are some tips for thinking through claims that mutations make new information. Welcome to Critical Thinking Skin, where we look at how you can think about any faith-challenging message and arrive at a biblical, logical conclusion yourself. I'm Patricia Engler, and today let's look at ways to think through claims that mutations supposedly add the kind of functional new genetic information required for molecules to man evolution. First, what's the observational science in such claims? What facts are being observed in the present? Typically, researchers are looking at DNA sequences. If they documented some change taking place in the present, you can ask yourself, does this example involve something happening to genetic information that already existed? Hint, the answer will almost certainly be yes. So the next question is, what was observed happening to that pre-existing genetic information? Often, the answer may involve one of four processes that we can document happening right now. Process 1, duplication of information. A main mechanism for evolution is supposed to be accidental gene duplication. The duplicated copy can gather mutations, which will likely be neutral or harmful, while the original copy continues functioning. Now, duplications themselves don't add new information, they just repeat existing information. Further mutations may occasionally let duplicated genes adapt to different functions within kinds of living things. For example, as a linked article explains, mutations to duplicated genes may be responsible for the emergence of venom in some animals. Again, this doesn't involve the creation of new information so much as the corruption of existing information. And it helps explain how things like venom could have developed from other substances after sin, given the original genetic information in God's very good creation. So that's process 1, duplication. Process 2 involves losing control over how genetic information is used. For instance, like episode 35 explained, bacteria can become antibiotic resistant when mutations make them lose control over how much protein they express from a gene. These are often called gain-of-function mutations, but they're really just loss of control over existing information. Next, process 3 involves the degeneration of existing information. For instance, some bacteria have proteins that digest nylon. Since nylon is a human-made material which hasn't been around for as long as the bacteria have, this is considered great evidence for evolution. But a little digging deeper into observational science, which you can see through a linked paper, explains why the bacteria could digest nylon. They didn't evolve a new gene for a new protein. They already had genetic information to make proteins that digest carboxyl esters, which are similar to nylon. But mutations deformed the proteins to lose their specificity for carboxyl esters, making them able to digest nylon too. As doctors Georgia Purdom and Kevin Anderson explained, the beneficial phenotype or trait of nylon degradation requires the a priori existence of the enzyme and its specificity. Its degeneration is not a mechanism that accounts for the origin of either the enzyme or its specificity. Well, what about process 4, the transfer of information? Bacteria, viruses, and other organisms have built-in mechanisms for trading genetic information back and forth, and the mobile DNA sequences mentioned in episode 73 can let information move within or between organisms too. But transferring existing information doesn't create new information. It's sort of like how if I gave you an old book, that book's information might be new to you, but the information had already existed. So those are four processes we can observe happening now. Looking at DNA sequences to speculate which of these processes might have happened in the past is historical science. For instance, researchers might observe similar genes within or between organisms and, based on evolutionary assumptions, speculate that those genes originated through duplication and mutation processes. For instance, humans have 5 beta globin proteins serving similar but specialized functions. Evolutionists suggest they arose through duplication and then differentiated through mutations, but creationists suggest it makes a lot more sense to say that the genes were created and organized to work together effectively. Both of these are interpretations from historical science, and you can learn about their respective weaknesses and strengths in the linked resources. Ultimately, for any observational process said to be examples of evolution, you can ask, if this sort of thing happened over and over, would that naturalistically produce life as we know it? Hint, the answer will be no. For more on how to think critically about any faith-challenging message, you can access my other CT scan videos packed with tactics, tips, and tools that helped me as a Christian student at secular university. Thank you for watching. Hey, it's Patricia. Just wanting to let you know that if you like these videos, are on board to share the message of biblical authority, and want to give, you're welcome to help Answers in Genesis produce more content like this and equip more people to defend their faith by making a one-time donation or becoming a monthly supporter by clicking the link below. Thanks so much.